5th Guards Tank Army was a Soviet armored formation which fought in many notable actions during World War II. The army was formed in February 1943. Until July 1944, it was commanded by Pavel Rotmistrov. Its organization varied throughout its history, but in general included two or more Guard Tank Corps and one or more Guard Mechanized Corps. It was considered an elite formation. Under Red Army doctrine of deep operations, tank armies were primarily to be used for large-scale exploitations of major offensives. Once a breach in enemy lines had been made by other units, typically shock armies or combined arms armies, the tank army would be inserted into the gap to drive deep into enemy territory, attacking rear areas and major communication centers to disrupt the enemy reactions. Tank armies were expected to penetrate up to several hundred kilometers into the enemy rear. In 1943, this tank army played a significant role in the Battle of Kursk, being one of the formations tasked with the counterattack at the Battle of Prokhorovka. At Kursk, the army controlled the 18th Tank Corps, 29th Tank Corps, 2nd Tank Corps and 5th Guard Mechanized Corps, plus smaller units with a total of approximately 850 tanks. According to the plan of the Soviet High Command, the first mission of this huge armored formation was to attack and destroy the 1st SS Panzer Division Leibstandarte SS Adolf Hitler on the 12th of July 1943. In the Battle of Kursk, the attack of the 1st SS Panzer Division commenced on the 5th of July. By 9th of July, the division had advanced 48 kilometers north and were nearing the small town of Prokhorovka. The 2nd SS Panzer Grenadier Regiment, supported by several tanks, advanced up to the road to Prokhorovka against heavy resistance. By the 11th of July, the infantry had cleared a state farm and began the attack a hill position, which they secured shortly. In the morning of the 12th of July, the engine noise of the Red Army's 5th Guards Tank Army roared from the direction of the Prokhorovka. Hundreds of Soviet tanks in waves of 40 or 50 with Guards airborne riflemen piled on top of them rolled out the town and surrounding area. Sturmbannführer Joachim Peiper's battalion was dug in on a hill which had been captured on the previous day. At 8:30, Soviet artillery bombarded the position for 15 minutes, and after that Peiper's men began to hear the noise of hundreds of tank engines. There were no friendly units on either flanks. At around 9 o'clock, Peiper's forward outpost spotted the mass of Soviet tanks heading their way. Paratroopers from the 9th Airborne Division were riding on the back deck of the tanks. Peiper hurriedly fired up purple smoke to indicate enemy tank attack. The Soviet tanks charged at great speed, colliding head-on with the SS Grenadiers and SS Major Martin Gross' 2nd Panzer Battalion. An SS officer related, "They were around us, on top of us and between us. We fought man to man, jumping out of our foxholes to lob our magnetic hollow charge grenades at the enemy tanks. It was hell. Our company alone destroyed 15 Russian tanks." SS Obersturmführer Rudolf von Ribbentrop, son of the Nazi foreign minister, commanded a company of 6 Panzer IV tanks, which drove down a slope to aid the hard-pressed Panzer Grenadiers. Ribbentrop's company knocked out a handful of T-34s at 800 meters. The Panzer IV, the most common German tank at Kursk, was not as fast as the T-34 or as heavily armored, but it had a superior gun and fire control. In the end, tactics and training proved decisive. Soviet infantry, dead or alive, were heard of the burning tanks. With its infantry seeking cover, the Soviet armor bravely sped on until the tanks of both sides slid through each other. There was neither time nor room to disengage from the enemy and reform in battle order or operate in formation. The shells fired at close range pierced not only the side armor, but also the frontal armor. Ribbentrop knocked out four more Soviet tanks. On the last one, he scored a direct hit at 10 meters. Ribbentrop had turned with the waves of Soviet tanks that swept by him. Soon they were under fire from German assault guns and two more panzer companies lurking down the slope behind an anti-tank ditch. Suddenly, a wave of 60 Soviet tanks swept out of a wood less than a mile away. Second Lieutenant Mikhail Wittmann's Tiger rocked from the recoil as his 88mm gun knocked out the first T-34. The Soviet tanks fired on the go, rapidly closing the distance. Four Tigers were hit and temporarily crippled. Wittmann's Tiger shuddered from two hits, but remained unfazed, although his radio operator received a wound in the upper arm. 3 o'clock, 300 meters, cried Wittmann. A T-34 appeared out of some bushes. It swung its 76.2mm gun towards Wittmann Tiger, but Wittmann's gunner, Balthasar Wohl, was faster. The 88mm muzzle flashed and blew the turret off the T-34. Wittmann's platoon of three Tigers pushed on through the storm of steel, through the flames and smoke of burning grass. He had passed Prokhorovka when a voice rang through the radio. Achtung! Strong force of enemy tanks approaching from ahead. Many tanks. Soviet tanks of the 181st Tank Brigade closed in from about a mile away, disappearing into a valley and then reappearing over a rise. The Tiger's guns operated and maintained a rapid rate of fire. Numerous Soviet tanks were blown to pieces, but the remaining machines kept coming. They had to close to within 800 meters to be able to penetrate the Tiger's frontal armor. Leading a group of 15 tanks, Captain Skripin's T-34 closed in on Wittmann's platoon. "Forward! Follow me!" he shouted. Skripin fired a round into a Tiger's side, disabling it. Wittmann's Tiger responded by pumping two rounds into Skripin's tank. Skripin was wounded and his crew pulled him out of the burning T-34. Despite horrible losses, the Soviets kept on the pressure. The Leibstandarte's efforts to advance were prevented by packs of Soviet tanks and infantry. A tank crewman recounted, "Salvo after salvo of Stalin's organs rained down upon our positions, with artillery and mortar shells in between. T-34 after T-34 rolled over the hill. 3, 5, 10, but what was the use of counting?" At one point, Soviet tanks threatened Leibstandarte's command post and engaging its artillery regiment in point-blank range. But, by mid-afternoon, the sky broke into heavy showers. Rain sizzled on swaths of smoldering tank carcasses and roads turned into mud pits. Combat in the sector ground to a halt. Both sides were too drained by the terrible ordeal to go on. The cost had been extremely heavy. The 5th Guards Tank Army lost about 650 tanks, although only 250 or so of them were total write-offs. Gross Battalion alone accounted for 90 Soviet tanks, earning him the Knight's Cross. The Leibstandarte lost just over 60 tanks and the assault guns completely destroyed. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe and support my channel on PayPal. Details in the description box.